When Apple introduced the iPod in 2001, they pioneered a new kind of physical listening experience and changed music forever. How it was consumed, how it was distributed, and even how it was created. Seemingly made obsolete by the streaming age, original iPods are practically antiques, ancient technology not even two decades old. To service anything more than a battery issue requires a full replacement from Apple or a visit with a sketchy black market repair service working out of a van, apartment, or back room. But are iPods actually obsolete? Halfway between the infinite customization of cassettes and the celestial jukebox of the internet, iPods converted millions to the joys of portable shuffle play Satori. Loading an iPod with a personal arsenal of leaked albums, durable classics, Napster finds, and random bootlegs from the file-sharing wilds was only one of the 21st century surprises iPods offered. Perhaps the iPod's most distinct innovation was its ever-so-visceral scroll wheel, imbuing MP3s with their own tactile quality, comparable to the feeling of thumbing through CDs or LPs, but a sensation all its own. With a sleek look, masterminded by design engineer Jonathan Ive, who became Sir Johnny Ive for his work at Apple, iPods seemed as if they teleported directly from Stanley Kubrick's 2001, A Space Odyssey. Part futuristic technology, part evolutionary monolith. Like vinyl, iPods offered a way to listen to music unmatched by any other platform. Essentially hard drives with headphone jacks, the original iPods were single-use devices, and that use was music. A dedicated tool for music lovers to escape the world, far away from phone calls, text messages, email, and other modern intrusions. Following their original white design, iPods blossomed into many colors and shapes, from the no-screen shuffle to the Wii click wheel of the Nano. But in 2007, the iPod Touch came to devour its elders. Released just after the iPhone, it was essentially just that, minus the phone. Gone was the click wheel, replaced by the black mirror of the iPhone's touchscreen. Now one could have all the music they wanted, alongside apps and maps and Swiss Army knife-like tricks, and all the free surveillance they could handle. Meanwhile, Apple's iTunes app started bloating with new features at seemingly every update. Ping, Genius, iTunes University, ringtones, TV shows, unasked-for U2 albums. Even docking an Apple device became a time-consuming adventure. In 2007 as well, Apple rebranded the original iPod as the iPod Classic, and probably simultaneously sounded its death knell. Within 7 years, it was gone too, the last click wheel rolling off the assembly line in 2014. Apple's focus on so-called smart devices was also the destruction of the greatest personal listening tool ever invented. Where streaming services offer instant access to seemingly gazillions of songs in return for recording listening habits for marketing data, iPods provided a personal musical experience, where a phone call from a telemarketer wasn't going to suddenly override your jams. What was once a simple but glorious promise by Steve Jobs of 1,000 songs in your pocket has become much more than 1,000, and much more than songs. But for those who only want to listen to music, and a lot of it, the original iPod still feels like a device from a fantastic and distant future.